read some passages. You turn to God from idols to serve the living and the true God. And emphasize that word turn, 180-degree turn that you made from idols to serve the living and the true God. That is the beginning of the story. Galatians 4, 8 and 9. You were enslaved to beings that by nature are not gods. Now, however, that you have come to know God, you were enslaved to beings that are not gods, but now. Or 1 Corinthians 6, 11. This is what some of you used to be, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of our Lord Jesus. Ephesians 5, 8. Once you were in darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. These are the ways you also once followed, when you were living that life, but now you must get rid of all such things. Colossians 3, 7, and 8. Or I might go back to Romans 6, 17. You, having once been slaves of sin, have become obedient to the heart. 6:18, Romans 6:18. You, having been set free from sin, have become slaves of righteousness. As you once presented your members as slaves to impurity and to greater and greater iniquity, so now present your members as slaves to righteousness for sanctification. When you were slaves to sin, again, Romans 6:22, you were free in regard to righteousness. But now that you've been freed from sin, the advantage you get is sanctification. Or Romans 7:5-6. While we were living in the flesh, our sinful passions were at work. Now we are discharged from the law, dead to that which held us captive. Now I want to call to your attention, we always read those yous as individual. This is corporate. You people once were in darkness, and now you have a new beginning. Life began again. Now he's telling this to people who have made that change, and they are in the middle of a story. And so what we are, we are a community of memory, people who look back and recognize that from that darkness from which we came. Now, in an environment when people come out of paganism, that's easier to understand the radical change. But I think we who live in a somewhat quasi-Christian society, have no way of missing the fact that there is darkness outside. There is darkness from which we have been rescued. And that God did begin a good work with a community. We're in the middle of that story. As I read the book of Romans, so many people quit reading Romans about chapter 4. Traditional Protestantism, again, has read up until chapter 4, and that is how we came in. Because that's what chapter 4 is about, how we came in. And so chapter 4, if you remember that those deadly sins that he describes in chapter 1, the wrath of God is poured out on all who know God, but they engage in all these vices. If you go over to chapter 6, he says that's where we were. We were rescued from that world. Now, Paul also looks to the future. As I mentioned a moment ago, we're in the middle of the story and in all of the passages where Paul talks about his prayers. What will you be like at the day of Christ? Christ. So in Romans 8:29, there is the time when we will be conformed, soon morphomed, that is, transformed, conformed to the image of his Son. There is the future. That almost the same statement is made in Philippians 3:20-21. We're waiting for a Savior who will transform our bodies into his. The ultimate goal, then, is to be transformed into the image of Christ. Where are we right now? Where are our churches? What progress have we made? Well, God began a good work, and God is going to bring it to completion. The present is a time of moral formation. The present is a time when we are transformed into his image. I'd like for you to take in your Bible and look at a couple of passages that talk about transformation. What does it mean to be transformed into the image of Christ? And I want to look at several passages that talk about this transformation. 2 Corinthians, as I mentioned, is a book in which Paul is defending his ministry. And in his opening, he does not have the traditional thanksgiving. He has the Jewish barakah, the blessed be God. It sounds like the Psalms. The God who comforts us in all our afflictions so that we can comfort others. Now, that's actually Paul's self-defense, because he's a suffering figure, and for that he is being criticized. He's not the Greek he man. God comforts us in all of our afflictions. But, verse 6, if we are in tribulation, it is for your comfort and salvation, for your comfort that is working in you in patience of the same sufferings which we also suffer. He is a suffering figure, but if he takes up the cross, that's the identifying mark of Paul. If he takes up the cross, then he assumes that his congregation also will know formation, which is to share in the destiny of Christ. That is what spiritual formation is, to share in the destiny of Christ. In chapter 3, verse 18, in the middle of his argument, he talks about formation. And he talks about his own formation. But there is a line where he makes the switch from we, and just as a side note, we in 2 Corinthians, most of the time, if not all the time, means I. This is a defensive speech. So we, starting in 3:3, manifesting that you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in stone tablets, but on fleshy hearts. And then he goes on to say that you, of course, are our letter. Now, he goes through a passage telling the story in chapter 3 from Exodus chapter 34 about Moses. Moses coming down with a shiny face. And he says, the people at the time just couldn't take it. They couldn't accept it, the shiny face. But then he goes on to the last verse, and one that we should recognize the context, the last verse of chapter 3. The last verse, but we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. You notice he switched from we to we all. That is, Israel couldn't see the glory, as Paul tells the story. They couldn't see the glory. But we're not like Israel. We all are being transformed from one degree of glory to another. Now, in our passage, the Greeks appreciate the person who demonstrates great physical strength and power and beauty. And he says, we are being transformed into the same image. Now, if you keep reading 2 Corinthians, you read Paul say in 4:10, always carrying around the dying of Jesus. He's talking about himself. But he's also, if you go back to 3:18, talking about us. Where is our church, and what were the values that we inculcate in our churches? For Paul, we all being transformed into the image of Christ means we share the destiny of Christ, which means we're less selfish, less self-centered, that we are looking out for the good of others, that we're willing to suffer on behalf of others. We all are being transformed into his image. That's what should be happening. And I would say to every minister, when you think about what you're doing over a year's time, does the teaching create a mindset in which we are being transformed into the image of the crucified one? That's what he means, into the image of the crucified one. Does our preaching amount to putting that vision before people that we are being transformed? That is spiritual formation, to be transformed into his image. I'd like to take you to another passage where he uses the word morphe, and that's in Galatians. A turning point in the book of Galatians is where he's made his argument. And the argument has to do with who really belongs to the people of God. And he's giving them a vision of a kind of community they've never seen before, where people cross social and ethnic lines to sit down together. That's the kind of church we are. No longer slave or free, male or female, Jew or Gentile. That's the kind of church we are. But you know, they've relapsed. Are they really being formed and transformed? That's kind of the question we ask. What progress have we actually made? That's the question we do ask. And then there's the line that Paul says after he has made his argument, he's chastised his community, and then in chapter 4, verse 19, little children, my children, with whom I am the pangs of childbirth, until Christ be formed in y'all. In the community. I think J. Lewis Martin in his commentary on Galatians says a good rendering of this would be, until Christ is formed in your congregations. Actually, the Galatians are not just one congregation, there are churches of Galatia. I'm in the pains of, he is the pregnant, expectant mother. The church is the fetus. And he is in anxiety because they have relapsed. And he wants Christ to be formed in them. Now, I think any minister, any church leader, know something about the pains of childbirth when you begin a good work. What is going to happen? And here is the expectant mother, very concerned, is Christ going to be formed in them? Well, I think he goes on to say what spiritual formation means. Because if you read the last two chapters of Galatians, There is, Paul says, you have entered the new age of the Spirit. Now live that way, in the new age of the Spirit. And you know, the works of the flesh, well, that's the old self. That's what you used to be. But the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, that's what happens if you don't relapse. And I guess we're all concerned about relapsing or making continuing progress. You notice when Paul gives ethical advice, you notice all of the vices really are antisocial vices, strife, enmity, the sexual vices. They're all antisocial vices. You know that the fruit of the Spirit, they're all communal virtues. Love, joy, peace, patience. That's what it takes to live in a community and be transformed into the image of Christ. You have the same thing in Romans, and I think we are very familiar with Romans 12, 1 and 2. Many of us memorized it long ago. Don't be conformed to this age. After all, you left that age. Don't be conformed to this age, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The Greek word used here is the same word used in 2 Corinthians 3:18. It means go through a metamorphosis. That's the Greek word, metamorphosis. And then he tells us what it looks like to go through this metamorphosis. First thing you do when you go through the metamorphosis is you don't think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. 12:3. And what that means is you live in a body and you use your gift for the good of the body. And then when you go to 12:9, let brotherly love continue. In the research that I have done, I've never seen the word brotherly love, Philadelphia, used for anything other than actual siblings. Paul has taken strangers and turned them into a family. And what brothers, real brothers, do is practice Philadelphia. Plutarch has a whole essay on Philadelphia, how siblings should treat each other. And transformation means acting like a family, like a good family. Philadelphia, let it continue. And then he gives all the descriptions of what Philadelphia looks like, hospitality, contributing to the needs of the saints. All of those are the elements of transformation. So transformation is corporate transformation. Spiritual formation is corporate. Well, I have focused on Paul's use of the word morphe and on his ambition. I want to pick up two other words that really mean transformation. The first word is sanctification. They taught us long ago that sanctification means a process. That's mostly true. Romans 15, about verse 20, he says, what I want to do is present a sanctified people. That's my life ambition, to present a sanctified people. Or the prayer in 1 Thessalonians 3, may God sanctify you wholly before the coming of Christ. That is, it is a process. And that is formation. But I want to spend my last few minutes on another word that often gets overlooked. Paul describes the church as a building under construction. You read 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He uses the metaphors of planting and construction. And they're great metaphors for showing the process of formation. You don't just plant. You have to water to see that the planting is not the end of the story. Then you have the metaphor of the building. And he really goes on and on about that metaphor of the building, beginning in chapter 3, verses 10 through 17. I laid a foundation. The foundation is Christ. That's when the church began. And it's going to have an end also. But right now, we're building the foundation. And you better watch out how you build on to that foundation. That foundation, that building, is going to be under stress. It's going to be fire, however he means that, I don't know. But it's going to go under stress. So be careful what kind of construction materials you use. That's the church. He never talks about growth in numbers. He talks about growing up. A building under construction. Now, he doesn't leave that metaphor, the building under construction. He stays with it. And when there are people who are insisting on their own way, going to the banquets or where they have food offered to idols, remember he says, we all have knowledge, chapter 8, verse 1. Knowledge puffs up, love builds. And he doesn't leave the metaphor there. I think five times, and by my count, in 1 Corinthians 14, you have either the verb or the noun. Oikodomeo is the verb. The noun is oikodome. And we have a chaotic worship service. And Paul says, let everything be for oikodome, for building. Building under construction. What should happen in worship service? Does it contribute to the formation, the building that God is building? I know it's almost a cliche that worship is for edification. But that's usually individualized. And the person goes away and says, yeah, I was edified today. I was not edified today. That misses the point. The point is the church, the corporate community, is under construction. And when Paul says, let everything be for edification, he is asking, does the worship service lead to the construction project? Not whether I felt edified. The construction project may be taking place when you don't feel it. But that is the formation that he is talking about. Well, we have great challenges before us. As I mentioned yesterday, our challenge is to build a community corporate formation in a very individualized world, where people think of the church as a social contract. And that's so far removed from what you see in Scripture. And I come back to the fact that the church is telling a story, and I'm part of it. And it's going to hurt at times. It's going to have strife. It's going to have division. It's going to have pain. But I'm a part of it. It's my church, God's church. And as we go through, we'll have happy moments and moments of sadness. But the church has a beginning, a middle, and an end. And I think it's worth our while, in all of our congregations, saying, where do we stand in that story? Are we moving toward the goal of a blameless people in Jesus Christ, a formed people? Do we know what the task of loving one another really means? Not just empty words. But when the early Christians talked about love, they meant that acting like family, being the social safety net for others in the community. common with you. That's what formation means. The last passage where I think about formation being used, Jesus Christ in the form of God, took on the form of a slave. When Paul writes in chapter 3 and presents himself as a model, he says, I am conformed to his death. And that is a model. Formation means taking up the cross with Jesus Christ, a life of self-denial,